uncharted territory because we are just learning how to deal with the aftermath of war, or actually just war still going on there in some pockets, excuse me. So Pakistan is much easier to work in. But in Afghanistan, there are so many challenges that I don't think that we can even consider what's the next step about Afghanistan. I don't think we're going to go into Nepal or China just yet. That's, I mean, enough for us right now. I think scholarship program is something that's very close to Greg's heart, and he is really committed to the idea of a global mandate for eradicating illiteracy. So don't be surprised if you see Greg lobbying for a global mandate in Africa, or, you know, trying to draw politicians for advocacy into eradicating all of illiteracy. I think 3-4 years ago, Greg's goal was 2015, but now it's getting more to be like 2030 for all you know, international communities coming together for an eradication of global illiteracy. Because he says that it will only take, I think, pennies to the dollar to eradicate illiteracy for the entire world, because there's, I think, around 147 illiterate children in the world right now, and he thinks with the people that have the money and the literacy can definitely address those issues very easily. Well, I didn't put anyone to sleep today, that's good. Sometimes I do see people sleeping, so this is a yay for me.
I know you're going through a lot of development work in these countries at this point in time. What do you think is the long-term future for these schools in terms of, specifically in terms of these communities being able to come in behind and support these schools over time themselves? I'm just curious. I know we're probably a long ways from that, but I was assuming that at some point Greg is giving that some thought too.
You mean about us letting go of the purse strings?
Right.
You know what, Greg is really smart, is that he's a very conservative spender, so even if he gets enough money, he doesn't go wild with just building schools, because he wants a long-term sustainability of each school. So he has come up with a plan for a 30-year sustainability model, so that he's endowing these schools with a 30-year development. So that way, because I remember him once telling me something really touching. He said that, Sadia, you know, because I was talking about that long-term development program, and I said, well, what's our mission? What's our agenda? You know, I want the results, and I want them now. So, you know, and he's a really calm guy and teaches me patience. And he said, well, Sadia, you know, you will not always be there. I will not always be there. But the schools will always be there. And the need for the children to go to school will always be there. So how do we fulfill that need? Because the generation will pass and new children will come that are illiterate in the population explosion, as I explained before, is growing. So he said that we definitely need to have an endowment for each school, so there's at least 30 to 50 years for each school to sustain itself. And then we also do ask for the community to match its labor. But about the sustainability development, if you look at each village that we build a school in, what I was really happy to see, which I think should be in the book, is that we also lay a water line, a potable drinking system. I think Three Cups of Tea mentioned some of that. And then what we see as immediate results is that sometimes in the afternoons, especially in the colder regions, we double the schools as women's vocational centers. And with the women, we've noticed, not that you even asked me that, I'm just rambling now, that the women will ask their husbands and their sons to wrap up their grocery in multiple layers of newspaper. And then they will read those, because after many, many years, they discovered reading and writing, and they were blind to the world. And some Afghani women, I was talking to Wakil Karimi, he's in the book Stolen to School quite a lot. He's one of our amazing Afghan project managers. And he told me that a woman in Afghanistan said, the best thing about reading is that I can read signs and Kabul. And he said, what do you mean by that? He said, well, when I couldn't read and I was illiterate, I would just take off my head covering and just walk into a men's barber shop thinking, you know, it's a beauty parlor. And all these men with the Taliban and the rifles are looking at me like, what? And she's like, now I can actually read and not make those kind of mistakes. So those are some of the immediate impact of literacy.
I'd like to make sure that you all know that children can ask questions as well.
Children just probably want to go home.
Yeah.
They're hanging up in the trees afterward.
I'm like, that was a boring pennies for peace talk.
Yes, these children
the villages, there aren't that many opportunities for them. So what we do is we try to make sure that the girls who are getting the higher education from us do not fall through the cracks. I'm sure many of you read in the first chapter of Stolen into School about a girl called Lestreen Bay. And I think, Chris, you had also mentioned and talked about her in your sermon. So people like her, what we do with the people like her is we take them from their villages, we'll bring them to the cities, we'll train them with the promise that we'll pay for your education, we'll pay for your apartment, we'll pay for your family's expenses, with the promise that we want to take those resources that you've learned back to the community so that you can share those resources. Because a lot of times we say that, when we say that, oh, if you educate a boy, you educate an individual. If you educate a woman, you're educating the community, because women tend to reinvest into their communities 90% of their resources that they earn. Men, on the other hand, tend to only reinvent or reinvest 30% of their earnings back to their communities. Oftentimes, boys will go off to greener pastures in the cities, where girls will come back to their roots. So that's why we do encourage girls' education, but we always try to bring them back. The things that we train them in are midwifery. Case in point, Aziza. 10 years ago, we educated her. We only made an investment of $800. And in her little charcoal and belly, and you've probably all read about this in 3 Cups of Tea, her picture is there as well. There were around 20 women dying every year from childbirth. And 1 in 3 children died every year from infant mortality. After retraining, it's been a decade, we're proud to say that infant mortality has gone down to 1 in 8, and that not a single woman has died in childbirth in the last 10 years. So it can make a huge difference, just that reinvestment.
Key to heaven, and my father loves that. He's like, hey, stop debt three.